Hi everyone, today we have Professor Christopher Barratt. He's going to introduce to us some information about male infertility and how we diagnose male infertility. So starting with the fact that male contribute 40 to 50% of infertility, is there any treatment that a man can take to increase his fertility?
Well, there's a lot of treatments on the market that a man can take. Whether they work is another question. So for example, the most common thing is antioxidant type formulations. The question then is, do they really work? So when you look at randomized controlled trials, the evidence to support the use of antioxidant type treatment is very relatively poor, and there's a recent meta-analysis to show that. However, you know, you shouldn't really throw the baby out with the bathwater, because we don't really know how to diagnose men with high levels of damage, and therefore treating them is more difficult. So trials are needed to do that. You can't, and also the problem is giving men high levels of antioxidants when they don't need them can damage the sperm more than if they didn't take them. So I think you have to be very careful. That's the most popular one. The other thing is some men take testosterone. Believe it or not, we talked about this. It's completely crazy. And in a survey done in Canada on about 4,000 patients showed about just under 5% had on some sort of testosterone. Just trying to, you know, I've got testosterone, I produce sperm. If I take more, I'll produce more sperm.
I
mean, of course, it's a contraceptive. So basically, it drops sperm. But the good bit is, it's reversible. So if you talk to the patient, say, look, you know, stop taking it. But what was even more interesting about that data was half of the people who were taking the product were taking it just, you know, from the gym or on their own. The other half being prescribed to take it for treatment of infertility. Go for it. So you know, that's crazy.
So prescribed by their doctor.
Yeah, and this is very common, for example, in some parts of the world, West Indies, they're constantly trying to tell people, because you're already concentrating on, don't do that. Stop.
Yeah, like I know. But
the problem is that, you know, if you've got nothing else, people are scratching to know what to do. So that's the issue.
Like, I think also in Middle East, they use traditional medicine to treat infertility. And
what's,
I think,
more,
yeah,
what's that?
There's nothing, because like some people with very severe oligospermia, they start taking like honey or any other.
The evidence level that you could quote to that one would be absolutely useless. It would be a complete waste of time in doing that. So, but some men who take it may then show an improved sperm count. But they would have done that if they'd have looked at the moon all night. So I mean, it doesn't matter. So I think, but having said that, you know, we need to think of the man as not just a semen sample. He's a whole person, and therefore reducing their stress, making them eat properly, stop smoking. You know, that has a powerful effect, and actually we're underestimating that. So when you say what a man can do, what he can take, well, he can think a lot more about his lifestyle, and I think that would make a difference.
Like, stop smoking first thing.
If you're smoking, stop. Yeah. Might be right now, you know? And that, on its own, would make a difference.
But like, in the first place, are we good in diagnosis?
Absolutely useless. All we've got to do is count sperm, and we can't do that right. So, you know, I've talked at this meeting and shown data from the UK. So I start off my talk by saying, in the UK, you know, if you send a semen sample around to 100 different labs, you get, you know, 20 different answers, which is crazy. So everybody comes back to me and says, well, in the UK, you can't count. Obviously, because the UK, you know, you've even decided to leave Brexit, you know, you can't count. What's wrong with you? So then you show the data from Germany, exactly the same. Land of the free and the brave, America, exactly the same. The data in Australia, exactly the same.
What do you suggest we do? Because,
well,
you know,
we
it seems
can proper. There's methods to do it. People don't follow it.
Yeah.
So most of the data shows that people don't follow the methods. So in Germany, for example, 25% of the labs don't do internal quality control. So they don't even. I mean, it's simple stuff. Really simple stuff. You get an accurate diagnosis. You don't do it well, you're going to get a poor diagnosis. Not just that, you're going to give the patient potentially inappropriate treatment.
But how would you suggest that you actually get people to follow, you know,
because
the guidelines?
Basically, I think you then go on a course, or you talk to your local provider or the EQA scheme, and you say, look, count sperm, right? You know, And somebody who'd been counting sperm for 10 years diluted one. And I've been doing it for 10 years.
If we go more deep, like into morphology, because some, like in some lab they don't even do staining, they just do the morphology based on.
And then they say to you, oh, it doesn't work. Yeah, no, it doesn't work because you don't do it right. You know what I mean? If I say I want to try and score a goal, but I always hit the ball outside the post and say, oh, it doesn't work because I'm doing the wrong thing.
Yeah.
If you do the wrong thing, it's not going to work. Now it's an okay.
So if we go like deep in the treatment, so if we have a patient with a very low normal morphology, it doesn't really matter when we do ICSI or IVF?
Well, I think that you've got to work out what's a low morphology. So when usually people say 4% normal forms,
yes,
and then they don't understand there's no difference between 3% and 5%, because you need to count thousands of sperm. And so therefore, you know, you've got to be understand when somebody gives you numbers, we know, you've got to know the variation of that number, and that's the key for you. If you accept that, then morphology, as a in the old data, has a relationship to IVF success, but they were different patients, etc., etc. So I think morphology is critical when you're basically saying what is the production factor of this test is doing. Morphology helps you do that. Number of abnormalities per sperm, etc., etc. Globus of sperm, you know, all this type of stuff is really important. But in the majority of cases, what you're saying about the patient is no obvious abnormality. Not just that, not just no obvious abnormality, but it's basically it's within the norm of reference frames. So I think and if you've got a man with lots of sperm and they're moving well, generally those men don't have bad morphology because it's a production factor you're assessing. So there is a strong relationship between numbers of sperm, motility, and morphology.
Should we like consider maybe looking at the total number of normal morphology, not percentage of total
morphology? Well, actually, you think of morphology as what is the test is doing rather than just trying to set up some artificial thing. Some people use the number of morphologically normal sperm. You can't even comment on that.
So maybe we come to the end now and we have to thank
pleasure.
You.
Good
thank
to you. See you. Thank you.